Hi, everybody. Dr. Nick here. I just finished recording a great episode of The Hospitality Spirit with Trent Dang. Trent is the director of marketing at the Fairgrounds Racecourse and Slots in New Orleans, Louisiana. During our conversation, we talked about a variety of things related to the casino industry, specifically about the role of casino marketing, what it was like to open up a mega resort in Las Vegas, and some of the things that you can do to get your foot in the door in the casino industry. I hope you enjoy this episode. And hello, everybody. This is Dr. Nick Thomas with DePaul University School of Hospitality Leadership, recording another episode of the Hospitality Spirit podcast. Today, I'm joined with a friend, casino marketing guru, fellow UNLV alum, Trent Dang. Trent is the director of marketing at the Fairgrounds Racecourse and Slots in New Orleans, Louisiana. Trent, thanks for being on the episode today.
Hey, Nick, thanks for having me. Appreciate you thinking of me.
So, Trent, why don't we just kind of start out so the listeners kind of have an understanding of what you do. What does the director of marketing at the Fairgrounds Racecourse and Slots in New Orleans, Louisiana do?
Sure. We're a little unique. We are the third oldest thoroughbred racetrack in the United States, having been in full-time operation since 1872. First opened in the 1830s, but closed and opened a few times. So we consider 1872 as the opening day, if you will, or opening year. We also have, like many other race courses in the U.S., have a slots casino, a slots facility. So technically, we're what's called a racino, and that's your typical slots only casino. And then we also have, which is unique to Louisiana, we have 13 off-track betting facilities throughout the greater New Orleans region, about 60-mile radius. And those are not just off-track betting parlors, if you're used to seeing those in Illinois and in New York and places like that. But in Louisiana, we're a little unique where the off-track betting parlors are able to have an unlimited amount of video poker machines. So those are very profitable operations for us there. So as the director of marketing, I lead all the marketing initiatives through all those three entities, and they vary widely or wildly, if you will. On the racetrack side, there is a marketing component to hardcore race fans, but we also have a very large and successful, pre-COVID anyways, retail promotion-oriented large-scale events where we'll host anywhere from 7 to 10 large-scale events throughout the race season. And that is, we're talking 10 to 15,000 people in attendance with these promotions. So I will produce and manage all of those. On the casino side of things, it's your typical casino type of marketing where we're heavy in direct marketing, so heavy in direct mail. Specifically, a lot of data science that goes into who gets what type of offers to try to incent them to come into the facility. And then on the off-track betting facility, because there are so many, and if you don't know much about New Orleans is a very, everybody thinks of the French Quarter and Bourbon Street specifically, but this entire region is very, very diverse, and not just racially, but ethnically and as well. And so one of the parlors that could be 3 miles to the east of us can have an entirely different vernacular, entirely different set of cultural traditions, accents, things of that nature as 3 miles to the west of us here. So we operate those facilities more as a franchise type of model, if you think of a restaurant type of franchisee model where we will handle their overarching marketing concerns. We'll manage their advertising and the limited direct marketing that we do for them in consultation with them. But then we give them a budget. We manage their budget for things like promotions. And because they understand their markets better than us, then we just give them the tools to facilitate those promotions. So it's a very interesting dynamic here. Where there are a lot of racinos in the United States these days, but Most of those downplay the racing aspect, and we don't do that here. It's a full-fledged racing operation that's, in one of the, top tiers of the racing community. So you have to address those concerns. There's a full-blown casino that's there as well. And then, of course, you have to operate these mini casinos, if you will, all through the surrounding region. So very unique type of operation from what you see in other casino operations.
And that's really due a lot of people that, I worked in the gaming industry as well, and a lot of people don't realize that there's not a federal standard for what each individual state does in terms of how they create their gaming environment and what sort of gaming entertainment options they have. And that's really handled at the state and local level. So what you see in Louisiana, for example, might be very different than what you see here in Illinois. It might be very different than what you see in the state of Nevada, which kind of speaks to this unique hybrid casino racing environment, OTB, off-track betting kind of setup that you have down in Louisiana, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. And even within each individual state, you've got individual regulatory authorities that you have to deal with that could have very differing opinions. So in Louisiana, for example, we deal with the racing commission, who handles the racing, regulatory aspects of racing. We obviously deal with the gaming control board, which regulates the casino. And then the video poker operations, or the OTB operations, have to deal with both the racing side of things, because they do offer off-track betting, where you can wager, from here, you can wager on races in Florida or in Illinois and California. And you have to deal with the video poker regulators, which is a similar, but it's under the same auspices of the gaming control board, but a different division. So you're dealing with them as well. So even within this, within the state, you're dealing with multiple entities who all have differing interests. So the racing people don't care anything about what's going on in the casino world. They just want racing to, go off without a hitch. The casino folks, don't care about, racing. And then there's the video poker folks too. And then you also have to deal with, since we're in all of these local jurisdictions, all of the local regulatory things as well, liquor licensing, liquor licensing, your just normal occupancy licensing, taxes, and all of that stuff, which are all different because we're operating these 13 facilities in different parishes. We call counties parishes here in Louisiana. And so we operate in multiple parishes as well. So we're dealing with those local regulatory.
And then from a purely gaming standpoint, I mean, the fact that you have both commercial casinos, which a lot of people will associate with slot machines, table games, but then you've also got the paramutual aspect to it. So your knowledge that from you as the director of marketing, it's got to be pretty extensive in terms of gaming operations and the different types that you see. And for those that really aren't familiar with paramutual, what can you just walk the listeners through kind of what that means and how that might be different from slot machines and table games in the commercial casino side of things?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll admit I'm a casino guy. I came up through the ranks of casinos and not from the racing side, so it's definitely not my forte. I had to have a crash course in it growing up, although I did grow up, about a mile and a half away from a track in a different part of Louisiana, but I did have to have a crash course. But essentially, the biggest difference is that obviously, the outcome of a race, a thoroughbred race, is obviously dependent on which horse wins, that sort of thing. But the payout is the payout to the bettor is a function of how much is wagered. And how much is being wagered is largely and who races is largely a function of how much purse money the casino puts up. Right. So for race number one, how much the track puts up. So for race number one, if the track puts up, you know, $1 million, which would be a great race, you have a high quality of owners and trainers that'll want to participate in that race. And subsequently, you'll have a lot of bettors who will want to bet throughout the country, as well as your facility, that'll put money into that. And then the odds are set by the handicappers for the particular race. And then from there, the money is split up between all of the bettors, or between all of the winners, based on how much is being wagered on there. So that's very different than, say, a slot machine, obviously, which is a self-determination. There's a random number generator chip that sits inside of each slot machine. You press a button, the random number generator comes up with what combination of symbols will appear on your screen, which correlates to a specific payout, which then correlates into an aggregated hold percentage, or how much, you know, we would expect as a casino to win on each pull or in each game over the course or the lifetime of the game.
Sure.
So very, very different models there.
And the paramutual, I mean, I think some people, when they think of horse racing, they just think that it's the Triple Crown, Preakness, Kentucky Derby. But in reality, paramutual can be, there's dozens and dozens of horse races going on every day in the U.S., but then you've also got things like Highline and other types of events. But it's not to be confused with sports betting. So is that, but so there is a difference between kind of the paramutual aspect of horses and what you're doing, and then sports bets, correct?
Right, because sports betting is a handicapper sitting in a room somewhere saying that the Saints are going to win the Super Bowl. Which I really hope they do.
Saints fan here, full disclosure.
Full disclosure, lifelong Saints fan.
Go Ravens.
Okay. I did get to see the Ravens in the Super Bowl here in the Superdome. So that was a cool experience. But that's merely a function of the house. And the house trying to create odds that basically they're just hoping to break even on the bets on each side. And so if you did Saints versus Ravens in the Super Bowl, if they did that, you would say, well, we believe the Saints are, we're going to give you 14 points to the Saints because we think they're overwhelmingly going to win this game. So, the house will give you 14 points, and then hopefully that the bets will even out on both sides from Ravens fans and Saints fans. And then the casino makes money because if all the bets are the same, then they make money off the vigorish or the commission that they make off all of those bets.
Now, so then does the paramutual aspect of it? I mean, if you're OTB, are those set by the individual OTB? Are the odds of a particular horse winning, are those set by the individual OTB facilities, or are those set by the track where the race is occurring?
Yeah, it's at the track. It's at the track, the individual track.
Got it. That makes sense. How did you get to, so you and I first crossed paths when you were in Vegas. I mean, so what, talk a little bit about your background and the other casino jurisdictions and types of properties that you've worked at and what that experience was like.
Yeah, absolutely. I kind of, like a lot of people, stumbled into gaming. This was way back in the day when, you applied for a job by looking in the classifieds in the back of the newspaper. And I needed a job. And I was doing some part-time PC repair work to kind of make ends meet while I was in school. There was a job for an entry-level IT technician at Harrah's Casino. And I applied and I got it. And I was just the graveyard shift technician that would come out and replace the tape in the server for backups. If Nick called and said my email's not working, I'd go there and look at it and see if I could fix it, and did kind of whatever needed to be done from midnight to 10 a.m.
And a lot happens in casinos overnight. I mean, people have as somebody who's worked those graveyard shifts in casinos, it's people think, oh, it's going to be quiet, there's nothing going to be going on. And in reality, particularly in a place like Vegas, that's when Murphy's Law, if it's going to go wrong, it's usually going to go wrong on the graveyard shift.
Yeah, and from an IT perspective, definitely, because that's when, you know, there aren't that many.
Your backups and.
Yeah, you're doing all your backups, and then any kind of system upgrades that need to happen or things like that, or, you know, hey, Nick, we're going to upgrade your computer. I'm going to be here overnight, so just make sure to save everything, you know, so I can replace it while you're gone, and it'll be there for you when you get there in the morning. You know, all of that sort of stuff is kind of the stuff that happens overnight, or we're upgrading a system, so we're going to take, you know, the email system down overnight, and then Trent will monitor it, and that sort of stuff. So I just kind of worked my way up through that that organization, the IT kind of support and ops organization for a few years, and then ended up in New Orleans, where I opened Harrah's New Orleans, and doing the same type of role in a more senior role, and then had an opportunity to move to Vegas, where we met after a few years. And so when I was out in Vegas, I had wanted to move into operations, and just as a function of being exposed to it and wanting to grow, and you know, IT is great, and I enjoyed my time in IT, but you don't get to be a, you know, you don't, there aren't too many GMs that are, that come from the IT background, right? You have to have some operations experience. So I wanted to move into operations and get my feet wet there. And I had an opportunity to transfer into the slots department at Harrah's, which is now Caesars, which is now El Dorado, corporate office there in Vegas. So I took that job there in slots and learned the slots business. And we were doing, I was working on a lot of analysis type of projects where we were analyzing slot machine performance, selecting and implementing new slot technology, which is where my IT background came in.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like it would have been too difficult a transition.
Yeah, it really was. And just learning, you know, the operation side of things, which I wanted to do, which is what I was, which is, you know, what I was learning there, and learning on the analysis side, doing financial analysis in terms of understanding the profitability of certain themes and making recommendations on purchases. So that all that the analysis piece I knew, but in terms of, you know, what a red, white, and blue machine was versus a, you know, cops and donuts machine, and what a stepper reel was versus, you know, all of that sort of stuff was a little new to me. So that was cool. And I did that for a few years as well. And then I had an opportunity where you and I worked together to open up Wynn Las Vegas, and was very, very enamored with this idea of opening up this grand property. And we did that. And that was a great and interesting, you know, an interesting experience. Opening properties are always super, super fascinating. And
somebody gave me some advice one time. They said, if no matter what you're doing, if you ever have a chance to open a property, drop what you're doing and go do it. I mean, it was such a unique experience. I mean, we started, I actually started when it was still the DI, the Desert Inn.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Sure.
Yeah. Right. And we actually worked out of the old hotel rooms.
Right. I remember.
Which was great because everybody had their own bathroom.
Right.
And everybody had a balcony that they could look out onto the strip of the golf course. And then they imploded the Desert Inn, and then they started the multi-year process of building it. I mean, it was such a unique experience. And I still today, even as an educator, I fall back on some of the, whether it's leadership lessons or whether it's operations lessons or human resource challenges or whatever it might be. I mean, that was such a unique experience.
Well, especially at Wynn. So I've opened a few properties at this point in my career. And, you know, Wynn was especially, you know, interesting because it was the destination property in the world at the time, you know, when we opened it. And you know, and for better or for worse, you know, Mr. Wynn had this vision, you know, and that was very interesting to see his insight, all of the other stuff that's happened recently, notwithstanding, of course, but understanding what, from a marketing perspective, now that I have a marketing hat, you know, I have a marketing hat on, understanding what like a true brand looks like and what a really, really in-depth branding process looks like versus a lot of casinos and a lot of properties in the gaming industry where it's just a cool logo, or we'll redesign this postcard to make it look a little cuter, you know, that sort of thing, which is good and fine in a lot of markets where, you know, my grandmother doesn't really care whether or not, you know, the postcard is going to be, is going to win an Addy Award or not. She just wants to know when the slot tournament is, where she needs to be, and how much free play she's going to get, right? But it's a very different model at Wynn. And so that was probably my biggest takeaway from opening that property was being able to understand this is what a true branding process looks like from soup to nuts, meaning even from an HR perspective, like where you were in there. Okay, no, we have brand standards from a training perspective. We have brand standards from what the uniforms look like, what the drapes look like, what the matches look like, what the coasters look like. And of course, what the advertising looks like, right? Well, it's very, very different than a regional operator.
For those that don't know, I mean, what essentially happened, and it's a really interesting case study that, you know, Steve Wynn had built this, you know, for lack of a better term, he kind of was the founder of the modern day mega resort. You know, when he opened up the Mirage, nothing like that had ever been seen. And he built this really great and successful casino company. So he built Mirage and he built TI, and then they had Bellagio, and then they went out to Beau Rivage. And the way that they treated employees was like nothing that had been seen. But then there was the merger or acquisition, however you want to define it, between, you know, MGM and Mirage. And then Steve Wynn basically rode off into the sunset. And 5+ years later, then he decided to start a brand new company. And his whole thing was, we're going to do things even better. And I have such faith that we're going to do this better that I'm going to put my name on it. And, you know, that was the joke with the commercial, that this is so branded by me that I'm going to sign my name to the top of the building. And it was such a unique experience. And to your point, it was down to the such minute detail. I mean, I remember us sitting there trying to determine, you know, what the new hire orientation swag was going to look like. Like, do they get a shirt? Do they get a bag? You know, what's the backdrop going to be during this new hire orientation? Because, you know, when Treasure Island opened or when Bellagio opened, you could just take the employees from the existing hotels and bring them over. They already understood the culture. They already understood the way in which we, you know, the nomenclature for, are we team members? Are we associates? Are we colleagues? Whatever it might be. They knew it. They knew the company, but we were literally starting from scratch, and not many people could fully appreciate the complexity of what that involved with the opening of Wynn.
Yeah, you know, absolutely. And I think that's a great aspect too. This just this idea that no, you're starting from scratch with everything, right? You can't just copy and paste a training manual from a sister property, right? You know, that's, you know, and not only can you not do that, but Mr. Wynn wanted it a very specific way. You know, I know when you and I met, I had a lot of friends in brand marketing over at Wynn, and they had to present literally everything that would have a customer touch point to him for his approval. Again, down to coasters, down to matches, all of that stuff. And so to understand what that level of branding takes and what that looks like, because I came along a little bit later from that, but being able to witness that was a really, really great experience understand.
We were really what empowered. Real branding looks like. We were really empowered to be able to, you know, everything was on the table. I mean, I remember one of my very first meetings with the HR team and, you know, Don Merritt and Artie Nathan and that team. And we were sitting in a conference room and kind of talking about what this process was going to be like, because one of the initial things that where I was involved was the creation of the training material that, you know, hundreds and hundreds of different job descriptions that those job descriptions had to be written, and then all of the training guides had to be created for those positions. Again, when Bellagio opened, you could just take what was at Mirage or TI and, you know, change the wording and modify it slightly, but everything was on the table. And I still to this day remember this analogy that Don Merritt, who oversaw training and development, said. He's like, listen, when we create these training materials, you're going to have department managers and division managers and division training heads that are going to be coming from all different properties all over the world. They're going to be coming from Manor and Oriental. They're going to be coming from the Marriotts. They're going to be coming from places on the Strip. Think about the collection of all this as a big giant shoebox under your bed. And you take all these best practices from all these different organizations and you put them in this shoebox and you say, okay, who does what the best? So, you know, maybe Marriott does this thing really, really well, the arrival, the greeting. And maybe Manor and Oriental does housekeeping really, really well. And Four Seasons does service recovery and service failure really well. So it almost became this a truly multi-company style. I mean, everybody's fingerprint was kind of put on this. And I think that's what was so cool about the training process and how we developed it for the opening. And we had that luxury because this was a brand new company. I mean, in 2005, this was the very first hotel that Steve Wynn was opening and Wynn Resorts was opening.
Right. And for the most part, money was no object too, which is another interesting dynamic when you're doing casino openings or building new casinos, right?
$2.3 billion or $2.7 billion. Right. I mean, I think, and it was about 3,500 rooms. And just to kind of put a comparison, so the previous hotel that he'd opened was Bellagio, and Bellagio was about 3,500 rooms and it was about $1.3 billion. So billion more dollars on this hotel that was literally maybe less than a mile away. I mean, it's mind-boggling to kind of show that money truly was, I mean, clearly there was there were cost controls in place, but the amount of spending to do it right was remarkable. Particularly, I mean, the initial plans from what I understand was that it was only going to be a 400 room hotel. And then they realized very quickly economies of scale that they could just extrapolate and just get bigger, put more heads in beds. That meant more people in the casino because they had this massive property because of the golf course. And they said, let's just go bigger.
No, absolutely. Yeah, it was a little crazy. I remember also hearing stories from brand marketing where a lot of times the question was, okay, we're looking at Sheets or whatever. Like, what did we do at Bellagio? Is this better than that? Okay, well, then let's do it, right? And so, sure. Again, that interesting concept there. But
on the back to kind of the marketing side of it, I mean, the role of casino marketing is to drive, I mean, for lack of a better idea, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's basically to drive play. It's basically to drive people into the casino. But quite often, what sort of division within casino marketing do you see? I mean, do you have dedicated people for slots? Do you have dedicated people for table games? Do you break people up by region? How does that traditionally work?
It really kind of depends. There's a couple of different models that are out there, and it kind of depends on whether or not you're a standalone organization, whether or not you're a regional operator, a national operator, that sort of thing. But if you're talking what's really common these days in terms of multi-property organizations, there are really kind of three organizational models. One is totally decentralized, and we talk about this at in the classes that I teach about casino marketing. And when we talk about this subject, you know, I give them this example or this challenge, which is the best. So one is a totally decentralized model. Hey, Trent, you're down there in New Orleans. Yeah, there's a corporate office, but we're here just to basically make sure that investors are happy and bills get paid and stuff like that. But you're your own boss down there. You have your budget. As long as you make your budget, you'll never hear from us, right? On the flip side, there is a totally centralized model that's out there. And where that is, hey, Trent, you're there in New Orleans and your job is simply to execute what we tell you to do. And as long as you execute the promotion we give you correctly, if the rules are submitted on time, the car that you're giving away is displayed properly, you know, the queues are managed properly, all in staffing is good. That's your measure of success there. If nobody cares about the car and nobody comes, then that's not on you. That's on us at corporate. And then there's a hybrid model, which is probably the most common model these days, where corporate maintains some functions, where They may hire the advertising agency for you, and they will give you the brand standards. They'll work with the ad agency to come up with some concepts to give you for your branding. They may, in some places, may do all of your direct marketing for you, or may just dictate certain aspects of direct marketing. Like, you're in charge of execution, but you have to follow these certain guidelines, that sort of thing. And then, depending on which initiative it is where the accountability goes, right? So there, again, this hybrid model, and I've worked in all three throughout there. So from a high level, those are the kind of the three common models out there, and they all have their advantages and disadvantages. Mm-hmm. And that's why I challenge my students. Okay, well, let's come up with the advantages and disadvantages. And if you were a COO, a corporate COO, which would you choose? Now at the, go ahead.
Yeah. So I think when a lot of people think about casino marketing, they also think of this, and perhaps it's from the movies, they think of this image of a casino host, and right. They think of a casino host going around giving out, you know, free buffet tickets or free hotel nights, or all the way to the extreme of sending a private jet to pick somebody up and bring them in. I mean, so how does the casino host and the role of comps fold into that?
Sure. That's definitely a facet of casino marketing. Pretty much everywhere, even at small casinos, you know, you'll have at least one casino host or somebody doing that type of role, but it really kind of depends on the market as well. So obviously Vegas is very different than Macau, which is very different than New Orleans, which is very, very different than Greenville, Mississippi, right? So it really all kind of depends on the market and the level of player, of course. Certainly, I think if you had a $1 million player that just for whatever reason loved going to Greenville, Mississippi, they would warrant you sending out a private plane to that person and all of that stuff. But that just doesn't happen. But it does happen, or it did happen in Vegas before all of this mess came around, of course. And that model has changed as well, where instead of what you are picturing in the, you know, 60s, 70s, and 80s, where it's just literally guys in suits that are just running around.
Robert De Niro sitting at the
right, doing that sort of thing. It definitely has, there's still a little bit of that, but it definitely has turned a lot more analytic, which is like most things in marketing general, but in the player development world too. So, when I was in Vegas at the Riviera, and I had a pretty big, robust host team there on the strip, we would do all of those things, but it was very quantitative. I would say to a host who would come to me and say, I want to take some players golfing. Mm-hmm. So, okay, well, how much do you think it's going to cost? $5,000. I said, okay, well, here's your pro forma in Excel. And I would do a very simple, you know, kind of break-even analysis. And I was like, just plug and play in here. How many players you have, how much you think that they're worth, how much the golf is going to cost, how many days you think they'll stay versus going somewhere else. How many other offers do you think they'll redeem when they're here? Are you going to give them additional free play? Do they have any other free play offers that are out in the market? Okay. And come back to me with that and show me what the profitability is. And then if it's profitable, then yeah, you can have the $5,000. And it's a very different model than, 20 years ago, where it was like, oh, yeah, sure. Oh, who's going to go? Nick's going? Oh, yeah, Nick's a good guy. Here's $5,000, mm-hmm. right? So very, very, so same, but different. A lot more discipline these days.
Without getting, every casino handles this a little bit differently in terms of the type of data they collect. But a lot of people that are listening to this are maybe in finance or other areas, you know, here at DePaul or at other universities, and, you know, revenue management and data analytics is becoming very popular. I mean, what, again, not to give anything proprietary for your organization, but what sort of data do you traditionally collect on an individual? And is a lot of that just self-reported by the individual, or are you actually, do you have a research team that you go out and do you look at historical play? I mean, what sort of information do you collect to do that analysis?
in today's world, it's still very, it's been the same for the most part for the past 15 years or so, where players club card usage is the primary source of data. Mm-hmm. Meaning when Nick comes to the casino, he uses his card in the slot machine, or he gives his card to the dealer when he sits down to play. And the data that we collect from that is the primary source of data for, mm-hmm. for us to make our decisions. Here recently, we've done more, you've seen new firms that have come out in terms of doing predictive modeling and things of that nature, or database scoring, where mm-hmm. we can say, Nick just signed up for the club. And based on what we already know, that his age and his table games preference after maybe one trip, or maybe we're even seeing some firms that can say they can predict, you know, based off, you know, in real time, as soon as you start playing, we can get a really, really good sense of who you are. And then based off that modeling from other players, we can score you with a predictive value. And so from there, and this is very, very, very fringe these mm-hmm. days, but there are some firms that are doing this right now that can say, send an alert to a host to say, well, even though he's only been playing for 2 hours, we really, really believe Nick has the potential value of being a $1 million player based off of what we know about other players that are similar to him. So go out and talk to him, you know, that sort of thing. Again, very, very fringe, but there are folks doing it, especially in Macau and a handful of properties here in the U.S. that are very, very forward thinking. But primarily that data source is Players Club usage. There are some other places where they may track non-gaming spend, how much you spend at the spa, how much you spend in the hotel, and dining. Mm-hmm. The big problem there is that those systems aren't integrated, not natively anyways, they're not integrated, and they don't have any motivation to integrate with each other, even if they're in the same company. We even had, like when we were at Wynn, we had the hotel system and the point of sale system, and the restaurants were both owned and operated by the same company, but they weren't integrated with each other. They didn't talk with each other.
And that's so interesting, because we've had previous guests on the podcast that have mentioned just that very thing, that even within a big restaurant group, you might have different kind of brands within that restaurant group, and those POS systems often will not talk to each other, that they're right. still standalone. And I think for some people that in 2020, when we're recording this, that's a very interesting idea, that there still is not that integration. I want to talk just real quick, though, about, to go back to this idea of a players club, and people that maybe aren't familiar with what a players club is. And, you know, they might be familiar with loyalty clubs in the airline segment. They might be familiar with loyalty clubs inside the hotel segment. Is that kind of what you're talking about with the players club for those that don't know, or is it something a little different?
No, absolutely. It's put in your frequent flyer number whenever you book a flight. It is swipe or put in your telephone number whenever you go to the grocery store. That's really emerging these days, although I'm not really sure what they do with that data, because I don't really see much customized marketing coming out of Walgreens or...
I've seen it on my Amazon. I swipe right. my Amazon card every time I go to Whole Foods.
Amazon, absolutely. You know, they're world class about that, but... You know, but Walgreens, for example, I was there the other day and I put my telephone number in every day, and I get rewards points. And clearly they know what I've purchased because I put in my telephone number, but I don't get any differentiated offers, at least that seem differentiated to me at the very least.
There's a grocery store chain here in Chicago called Mariano's, and I've actually seen it quite well. So I will put my phone number in. And usually a week or two later, I will get a series of coupons in the mail specifically for the products that I had purchased on my last trip to try to incentivize me to buy more. So I think you're spot on that the grocery store kind of segment of the economy is starting to do this, and they're starting to do it pretty well.
Yeah. On the grocery store side, you know, we talked about, you know, maybe 10 years ago, why aren't they doing what the casinos are doing? Because they have the capability to have all this data. And largely that was a function of how they thought of marketing. So in the grocery store world, a lot of those places make money off of marketing because they have partnership deals with the with Procter & Gamble. They'll pay you to have the end cap for this month for the whatever soup or whatever Velveeta that they're selling. So the idea of spending money, spending a lot of money on a technology infrastructure to do this didn't make sense, even though you could, you could argue that you're going to see a quick ROI being able to do these differentiated offers like you're now seeing. But for a long time, and I still think for a lot of these smaller operators, it's a function of really not understanding what the ROI on what a loyalty club would give you. But when I talk about, to answer your question, but yes, when I talk about players club, that's our loyalty club. Just like, again, when you go to Walgreens, you put your telephone number in. When you swipe your card at Costco or Sam's, and when you put your frequent flyer number in, when you're purchasing a ticket, that sort of thing.
And from a, we kind of tie this all back to, and this is maybe as we wrap up, this is where I want to maybe finish us. You know, if somebody's looking to kind of get their foot in the door in casino marketing, or they're kind of looking to get their foot in the door in just casino operations in general, you know, the Players Club is a really great place to start. That, you know, it for lack of a better term, is the front desk inside the casino. That you can go there and you can ask questions. It's a customer service hub. That's always a great direction to enter into this side of the hospitality industry.
No, absolutely. If you're looking just to boots on the ground, get your foot in the door in casino marketing, that's absolutely a great place because you get to experience it all, as you pointed out, because you're the front desk, if you will. So you get exposure to direct marketing because people will come and ask you about their offers, and maybe you know, maybe you don't, or they'll ask you about what promotions are going on and why do I want to participate in that promotion, that sort of stuff. So you have to learn what that means, and you learn what moves that needle and what doesn't move the needle. And you get to learn the customers really well too, because you're seeing them, all the time to facilitate their transactions. So it 100% is a very good place to start if you want to get your foot in the door.
And it's also a great place if somebody's listening to this and they're maybe really interested in event management. I mean, and we have about a third of our students here at DePaul are interested in event management. And you know what? Casino marketing, great place for people interested in event management, because a lot of what you do is putting on events. And, in the case of you, you've got concert venues, but you've also got the slot tournaments that you do and things of that nature.
Absolutely. I was a little surprised. I'll admit, a few months ago, I was a guest speaker at the University of New Orleans here for an event management class. And I was explaining to them how, part of my job is exactly what you're talking about. No, I put on, we do have event sales that reports under me. So there's that traditional stuff like in a traditional hotel. But I said, no, I have to put together this car drawing, and the car drawing, I have to, make sure that I have to structure a deal with the dealership to provide a car. I have to get the car out here. I have to display it properly. There's marketing that goes into displaying that. And then certainly the day of, there is facilitating the event in terms of, okay, well, how many people are we expecting? Where are we going to do the drawing? Are there enough stanchions? And how are we actually going to facilitate the drawing? Is there audiovisual and all that sort of stuff that goes into traditional event management? And they were all like, wow, I didn't really think about that. And I was like, really? Or whatever. It may be a function of they were undergrads, they don't know a lot about casinos. But that was a little bit of a, maybe I'm too close to it after all these years. But, after explaining that to them, and especially after explaining to them the racing side, where we do 10 events a year that are 10,000 plus people and all the logistics that come with that as well, they were very surprised in terms of, that definitely was not on my radar. And now it is. I just was thinking of strictly going to a hotel brand. But yeah, absolutely. After I graduated, I'd love to talk to you more.
And it's not just, and again, back to my initial comment that, gaming isn't just something, and casinos isn't just something that's in Las Vegas and Atlantic City where people maybe think about it. I mean, it exists in dozens and dozens of states, have well-established commercial casinos that do events like that. Many of them have hotels attached to it. Many of them have multiple restaurants on property. So it essentially is a full service resort that has a casino attached to it. So, you know, it's a great entry into hospitality and tourism to get your foot in the door, learn those critical skills, whether it's customer service, critical thinking, marketing, event management, data analytics, revenue management. I mean, there's so many possibilities in this segment of hospitality and tourism.
I totally agree. For the most part, everything that you would find in a standalone hotel, you're going to find in a casino resort as well, for sure.
As we kind of wrap up the final question here, what if somebody's listening to this and all of a sudden now casinos has popped up on their radar and they're like, I think I might want to do this. What advice would you give them to if they want to either transition kind of mid-career into this segment, or they're a student listening to it and this is where they want to go? What advice would you give them?
You know, I would say, you know, I think the biggest thing is do what it takes to get your foot in the door. I will say, for better or for worse, there still is a bit of tradition, if you will, within the industry that, you know, you kind of have to start from the ground up. And if you're not a casino person, or if you didn't, you know, cut your teeth being a casino person, we want you to learn that aspect of it and be able to, you know, put that, you know, get that brand on your chest, if you will, that you're a casino person, even if you're coming out of hotels, right? And so, which is kind of a weird deal, but that's a legacy thing that's come out of, you know, 50 years ago. And that's changing, but there's still a bit of that out there. So I think the first thing would be, you know, one, just like you're saying, understand that your skills are relevant and they can transfer over. And then from there, just do what it takes to get your foot in the door and then just work hard, you know, and don't, you know, be open to anything, understanding that once you get your foot in the door, and this goes with everything, but gaming especially, once you get your foot in the door, you know, the opportunities will start coming to you if you work hard.
Couldn't agree more. Well, Trent Dang, you are a friend, a fellow run and rebel, and you are the director of marketing at the Fairgrounds Race Course and Slots in New Orleans, Louisiana. I want to thank you for being a guest on the Hospitality Spirit today.
Hey, thanks for having me again. And anything else you might need, just let me know. And hope to see you in the Super Bowl, Saints Ravens Super Bowl. Let's do it.
Go Ravens.
Who dat? Go Saints. Thanks, Nick. I appreciate it.
Okay.